7744 La Sala Boulevard. Explosion.
People miles away called 911 after feeling the impact of the blast, but no one could ever imagine the magnitude of what happened here.
And we have extensive damage.
Now to the deadly south side explosion that killed two people.
Within 4 minutes of the first 911
call, his brother Mark and Montserrat firefighters are accused of being responsible for the fatal
of the explosion suspects. Only an article in panic.
Initially, we didn't know on going on that run what actually caused it. We just knew it was a large explosion. Finding out later on that I guess the neighbors had been smelling gas for about a week or so, and actually some of the neighbors told me that. And I understand, I guess it was a microwave is what they used to detonate the explosion. It was, I believe, November 10th. I was the officer in charge of Engine 94. My lieutenant was off that night, so it was myself and two other firefighters. We read the pager and saw that there was it said there was a large explosion.
I am married to Chad Jackson, who is sitting next to me, and then I have four kids, Noah, who's 15, Faith, who's 13, Grace is 12, and this is Eli, who's 6.
It was very warm that night. We had been out in the hot tub and went to bed, and I'd probably been asleep maybe 45 minutes or so, and then I woke up to our alarm system going off, and there was a picture over our headboard of our bed, and that picture was lying actually on top of me. Fortunately, I had a pillow on my head, so it didn't like crack my skull or anything.
So he ran downstairs and told us to stay until he could figure out what was going on, and all the windows were blown out, and when he got down, the door was totally blown out, and he went and saw it was a fire, so told me to get the kids and to get out.
My friend, which was my neighbor, she was like our best friend, was sleeping with us because we were having a sleepover, and we were just in our bed going to sleep, and we heard like a huge boom, and we were just laying there, and we were terrified, so we were like, and we just heard like my mom yelling like, stay in your room, stay in your room. So we were just under the covers and we were just terrified.
They were all in their room scared. So I ran and got everybody and he was on my hip and then we just ran out.
It was amazing to see the blast wave, the pressure wave from this blast, because the front doors would be completely blown. The door was still intact, still locked, but the door would be blown completely inside the house. The garage doors would either be blown out or completely blown into the inside of the garage. And then when you'd search the houses, it was very strange because, you know, one room would be fully intact that's closest to the blast wave, but then you'd go to either the basement far room or the second floor, like in the far bedroom, and there'd just be, you know, sheets of drywall blown off the walls, or the room would be blown apart. Just that pressure wave was trying to get out any way it could, and it was real weird how sporadic it was as far as the way the pressure just kind of blew the house apart.
Our walls were just coming in. Like I said, lots of debris. Glass was everywhere, and that was an amazing thing. We had glass all over our floors, and all of us were barefoot in pajamas, and none of us had a cut on us, which was pretty amazing.
It was kind of a surreal moment. The sky had an orange tint to it because of the fires that were burning, and you know, it was probably 5 minutes or so before people really understood what happened. People were saying a plane had crashed. Others had said there was a terrorist attack, and there was a bomb. So. Just a lot of confusion and a lot of people in shock.
As far as you could look, any direction, you could see debris everywhere. But there's like water meter lids that were laying in the middle of the street. Normally those are up, you know, 15, 20 feet away. And those are pretty heavy and they're usually bolted down and they're flush with the ground, but they're laying in the middle of the street upside down, where just, again, the amount of pressure it took to blow that stuff out of is pretty amazing.
It looked like a bomb had hit us. I mean, it looked like a war.
When you look down that road where the explosion happened, I mean, it reminded me of what you would see in the movies, like a war zone. I mean, it's just debris everywhere. Looks like something after a tornado, just everything's obliterated.
I just remember seeing debris flying everywhere and insulation, and people were just running and screaming, you know, not knowing what was going on.
The whole time we're walking on 2 to 3 foot piles of debris. I mean, you couldn't walk anywhere without tripping and falling everywhere. At the time that this run came out, just again, that time of night, there's people sleeping, most people are at home. So the whole time in the back of your mind, you're just wondering, you know, how many people are buried in this debris right now. It still amazes me today that there wasn't more deaths in this explosion.
And then my phone was blowing up. I was the only one who got my phone out of the house, which, I mean, I'm a sixth grader. Of course, I'm going to grab my phone. I'm obsessed with it. But then everyone was like, are you okay? Are you okay? What happened? I was like, I don't know. So
my sister's like one of my best friends, so I knew just going to her house would help. So we went right to her house, and it was about 2 or 3 in the morning. So we lived there for like 3 weeks. And I think just being around people, being around family, and also telling our story in counseling, they always said, if you've told your story to 30 people, find 30 more to tell it to, because that's a way of coping. So we did tell the story a lot.
On Monday, I just remember I walked into school. I was just trying to hold back the tears because I knew that even the people who didn't say anything to me, they just looked at me, and I could just tell that they knew who I was, and I just was trying to hold back tears. And I walked in, and I remember like my guy best friend came up to me. He was the first person who said anything to me, and he just like gave me a huge hug, and he was like, it's gonna be okay, Faith. And he was like, I'm here. And I was like, thank you. And then all the teachers, they told me to go to the counselor, and I didn't want to talk about it to the counselor. I was like, I don't want to talk about it.
And I remember that night I had written a to-do list, and it was laying on the counter. And it's so funny because when I came down and I looked at it laying on the floor, and I thought, I mean, it's good to plan somewhat, but just to take one day at a time, you just never know, you know, what the next day has to hold and to enjoy today.
We have a lot of family. Both Abby and I's family are here, so good support structure, a lot of support from church. Multiple churches reached out. I know the middle school was good to Faith, and so just a lot of caring people, a lot of support. You know, it really makes you seek God and really feel what's important.
At first, I felt like I was like breaking down, but I had to be strong for my kids, and it just takes time. I mean, even at the year anniversary, I was still, you know, shaken up, and now it's been 2 years, and I know with time it'll get easier. It's something I'll never, ever, ever forget. And now at this point, I just want the court stuff to just be done and have closure with all the testifying and all that stuff. And once that's all out of the way, I think it'll be more closure.
Well, I think you grow up a lot, because I was a sixth grader. I mean, normally a normal sixth grader wouldn't understand or be forced to understand what like going to court was and insurance and all that. But I kind of had to pick up on that and understand that stuff at an early age. And also you learn a lot, like life goes on. You can't just like keep living in that. You have to keep going forward no matter what happens.
Mainly just thankful that we got out and were alive, because, you know, there were others that didn't make it.
Unfortunately, 2 lives were lost, but it's definitely, I was just still amazed that there wasn't more lives lost in that. Definitely the most devastation I've seen in the 10 years that I've been here, and hopefully I won't be a witness to another scene like that.
I met Jennifer initially through my position as PTO president at Southwest. She was not on the board at the time, but I just knew her because she was one of the teachers that I worked with on a fairly regular basis.
I had her in second grade, but when it actually happened, I was in third grade.
I knew her in a couple different capacities, and she was a phenomenal educator, very passionate about the work that she did. Loved each and every student.
She was really nice, and she liked the cult a lot.
She was really friendly, but she was also stern. Mm-hmm. She was funny, but she was also serious. And so she was just a really great person.
Once I got to know her, I really began to develop a real appreciation for her, mm-hmm. not just as a teacher, but as a person. She really had a way of connecting with the kids.
Mrs. Longworth was a serious teacher. She took her job very seriously. She would do just about anything if it meant thinking outside the box or trying new ideas to help students succeed.
She complimented us on a lot of stuff. And then whenever we, in the morning, she would ask us one question, and if we got it right, she would like give us a piece of candy.
She always had this sweater on the back of her chair that she never touched. And it just sat there. And I always thought of the sweater as her friend, because friends stick by and are there for you if you need them. And that's what that sweater did for her.
Now, as a PTO president, Working with her on the board, she was great. She was so, so creative. She always had lots of great ideas. She's a very creative person, was always willing to chip in and help whenever we needed her to do anything.
Well, she really, really, really liked to teach a lot, and it was like her passion. And she just loved teaching us kids, and we all really appreciated that. And she got upset with us from time to time, but she never yelled.
So that Sunday after the explosion, our entire staff spent the day here together, supporting each other and also trying to figure out what was going to happen next.
I literally just fell apart. I remember shaking and finding my husband and telling him I had to go. I said, I have to go right now. I have to get up to the school. And I told him not to tell Andrew. I said, poor Andrew. I mean, it almost makes me well up to think about it. It was a very, very hard day.
How could this happen? What happened? Who did this? She told me, and I'm just like, why would anybody do that? And I ran over to the couch, and I just started bawling all day, pretty much.
And I remember Beth Guilfoy, our principal, I was blown away at how strong she was and how she just commanded a presence that spoke volumes to all of the staff. You know, we're going to get through this. We're going to do what needs to be done. We're going to protect the kids. We're going to keep them away from the media.
The Friday before, Mrs. Longworth had everything prepped for the following week. So when the students came into the classroom, their morning work was already waiting for them, and she had put that out for them. We did a lot of activities with the kids that day, and I'll never forget, after about an hour of talking to the students, one of them raised their hand and said, "Can we just do our math now?" So the kids were just ready to get back to business.
It's one thing Jennifer always did every year for her class, all of her classes. She would knit the girls a scarf and each of the boys a hat. And of course, she was in the process of doing all this when this happened. And this store on Mass Avenue found out about it. And so they took it upon themselves to do that. And we had all these scarves and hats come into the school. It was amazing to us, the people that reached out to us.
It's amazing the support that we got from our own community here in Greenwood and then beyond. And so that really did open our eyes to just how much people really do care and are willing to offer support. Since the explosion, we as a school have been committed to keeping Mrs. Longworth's memory alive here in our building. I think through a negative situation, definitely positives came about. I think as a staff, we became closer together because we experienced this together.
Obviously, I think it was hard for all. Him being so young, I think he talks about it even at school, but he doesn't get the gist of, you know, it was done on purpose.
You want to say something?
Well, the most thing that I miss was my TV.
Your TV?
TV.
No matter like what was in our house or the house exactly, like that can, of course, I'll be like replaced, but I was so close to everyone and my best friend that lived next door, and we just kind of got torn apart really quickly.
There's no amount of material thing that can ever, you know, bring happiness or anything. I'm just thankful that, you know, it made our family a lot closer.
It's coming soon this year. We will be dedicating our library in Mrs. Longworth's honor.
She's in a better place right now in heaven, and I can't wait to see her one day in heaven. And I just pray for her a lot, and you know, God has a plan, and this apparently was part of his plan. We don't exactly know why, but it happened for a reason, and one day we'll find out.